morning, everyone. Welcome to our service this morning. Welcome to everyone here in Emmanuel Church, and also welcome to everyone joining us on Penny Church's YouTube channel. It's really good to be back among the land of the living again, having been absent the last two Sundays because we've had to have a lockdown in our house, not because of me, but one of the family members. So it's I'm grateful to Reverend David Kennedy for taking the services for me in my enforced absence, but I'm really pleased to be back amongst you. Actually, back to be just glad to be out of the house. Really. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Let us then show our love for him by confessing our sins in penitence and faith. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, we forget all who truly repent. Have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins. Confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please stand as we say together the glory and trust. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God, Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of Father, receive our prayer. For you are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Almighty and everlasting God, by whose Spirit the whole body of the Church is governed and sanctified, hear our prayer, which we offer for all your faithful people, that in their vocation and ministry they may serve you in holiness and truth, to the glory of your name, through our Lord and Saviour Jesus Christ, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please make standing. Gospel is taken from the Gospel according to St. Mark, chapter 1, beginning to read from the first verse.
Glory be to thee, O Lord.
Jesus left that place and went back to his hometown, followed by his disciples. On the Sabbath he began to teach in the synagogue. Many people were there, and when they heard it, they were all amazed. Where did he get all this? They asked. What wisdom is this that has been given him? How does he perform miracles? Isn't he the carpenter, son of Mary, and the brother of James, Joseph, Judas, and Simon? Aren't his sisters living here? And so they rejected him. Jesus said to them, a prophet is respected everywhere except in his own hometown, and by his relatives and his family. He was not able to perform any miracles there, except that he placed his hands on a few sick people and healed them. He was greatly surprised, because the people did not have faith. Then Jesus went to the villages round there, teaching the people. He
called the 12 disciples together and sent them out two by two. He gave them authority over the evil spirits and ordered them, "Don't take anything with you on your journey except a stick. No bread, no beggar's bag, no money in your pockets. Wear sandals, but don't carry an extra shirt." He also said, "Wherever you are welcomed, stay in that same house until you leave that place. If you come to a town where people do not welcome you or will not listen to you, leave it and shake the dust off your feet. That will be a warning to them." So they went out and preached that people should turn away from their sins. They drove out many demons and rubbed olive oil on many sick people and healed them. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise be to you, Lord Christ. Please sit down. I've noticed that when our grown-up children come back home from their different universities, they go into what I call family mode. So people who are perfectly capable of looking after themselves, being independent when they're away from home at university, in close residence or in a student house, people who can cook their own meals or at least order Uber Eats or something like that, expect meals served up to them whenever they come back home. People who are quite able to catch a bus or a train or walk to places, expect a lift, expect to go in a car, be taken to places, but only when they're at home. People who are quite able to kind of tidy, well, I expect it in some way to tidy a house, expect it all to be done for them whenever they come home. It's a strange phenomenon, isn't it? I call it family mode. Go from student mode to family mode. One way of being, okay, into another way of being. Independence to dependence. Now, that's one way in which people can kind of exist in one way at some time when it suits them, and exist in a different way when they have to. I thought of this strange phenomenon when I read the Gospel story this morning about Jesus returning to his hometown and finding that people there viewed him in a different way than people viewed him everywhere else. It reminded me of a time when I myself was at first went off to university, and like many students, you'll find new things to do, new clothes to wear, in my case a completely new haircut, which I thought was quite normal until I returned home to find that what I regarded as a very trendy and up-to-date rather snazzy jacket looked rather a little bit out of place in a place where there were no massive students around. And the haircut that I had, which was actually quite different from when I went off to university, rather more sort of extreme version of the one I have now, sort of rather shorter at the sides and flatter on top. Rather, I imagine myself as looking like Morrissey, but I probably didn't. Nevertheless, but rather different than when I'd left. And my family, my friends at home, didn't waste any time in telling me. That was as nothing as what I imagined was going to be the reaction when I went off to my brass band that I played in. Brass band that was made up mainly of kind of middle-aged men and some teenagers. None of whom wasted any time in not telling people what exactly they thought. So I was a little bit apprehensive when I went with my new look back to my brass band. Also, I can say I won't repeat the comments that were made. All I can say is that I would like to be apprehensive to the comments that were made. Okay, so there's different ways of existing, different ways of people viewing other people. And this is a bit like what Jesus himself found, I think, in that when he returned home to his hometown. Different ways of being. Jesus then sends his disciples out with a kind of urgency. And I think there's a connection between these two things. I remember when I went off to my interview to my theological college, the one I ended up I was living in London at the time, and I thought I'd had plenty of time to get there. And I just had something to eat, made something to drink, and ambled out to the bus stop. And yeah, I should have time. And all the time was ticking by, And I actually missed the bus that I needed to get to the railway station. So I thought, it doesn't matter, because I'll get to the next bus. And I did. And I just about got to the railway station in time, and I just about made the train. So I often wondered what would have happened if I had missed that train, because I would have missed the interview to the place where I ended up going. See, I thought I had all the time in the world, but actually, there was a bus arriving at a certain time. There was a train departing at a certain time. Okay, I thought I was okay, but there was a kind of urgency there. And it's that kind of urgency that is behind Jesus' imperatives to those disciples to go out and preach his message. So what exactly is that? What's the connection between what Jesus was trying to communicate but couldn't because he was in a different kind of mode of being in his hometown, and those disciples that were given that urgency? Well, I think it's actually the message of repentance, that Jesus was teaching himself, and he was encouraging his disciples to go and preach. Repentance is a word that we don't naturally come to quite easily these days. It kind of has a connotation of guilt or a kind of grovelling about it. We used to see, when we were out to sports matches, you probably remember there's always a man there with a great with a pole, with a great sign saying "Repent, the kingdom of God is at hand," and shouting at people, "Repent, you sinners, you did it." That's the kind of things we think of, isn't it, when we think about repentance? At least I do. Actually, I've not seen anyone like that for many, many years. Maybe if any of you have, I think perhaps the world's a bit poorer for it, actually. But that nevertheless, despite those words never actually occurring together in the gospel, repent, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Don't go together in the gospels at all. But nevertheless, that's what the idea we think of when we hear that word repentance. What does it mean? Actually, I don't think it necessarily has to involve a sense of guilt. It certainly doesn't have to involve a sense of grovelling. What it does mean is a change from one mode of being, if you like, to another mode of being. A change from being in a kind of student mode to a different kind of independent mode. A change from being dependent to becoming fully independent. It's a whole about turn. In fact, that's what the word means. It's the Greek word in the Gospels. It's called metanoia. And it actually just means about turn. A complete change of direction. If we have done something wrong, if we have made a mistake, or if we're in the wrong, none of us really, I don't anyway, like to admit it. We kind of have a sense of being defensive ourselves, a reluctance to admit when we do something wrong. But I don't think that's actually what the word repentance means. That's kind of a confession. Confessing, learning to confess when you've done something wrong. Repentance is something much deeper and more powerful. The actual sense of that word, about turn, in the Gospels, in the New Testament, actually you can use it in the sense of a whole army marching in one way, stopping and turning and completely going in a different way. And it's that sense of a complete change, of not just one doing something wrong and then doing it right, a complete different way of being, like a complete change of mode of living. That's what that means. And that's the message that Jesus is trying to communicate, and he gives his disciples. A sense of not clinging on to something, but a sense of letting go. When I do a talk at funerals, most funerals, I use the image of kind of, excuse me, not hanging on to someone after they've gone to heaven, not on to the physical aspects of it. Because if you do that, your hands are clenched like that, aren't they? They're closed. But rather to let go, because when we let go, our hands are open. And when our hands are open, then they're open to receive God's blessing. And I think of repentance like that. It's a kind of not clinging on to ways of being which are unhealthy or stop us from developing, stop us from growing. But rather a sense of repentance is to let go of all those things so that our hands are open and they're open to receive God's blessing. It's sometimes said that repentance is the key to receiving God's blessing. And that's the message that Jesus is teaching himself. That's the message he gives his disciples to teach. It's the message he gives us to teach, really, and to live out in our lives. To literally repent of, to turn away from, to let go of one way of living, mode of being, in order that we can live in a more healthy, open, and whole way. To turn round, to change our way of living, and to let go, so that we're open to receive that blessing of God's love. Amen. So, you please stand as we affirm our faith with the words of our creed. We believe in one God, Father the Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth, Lord is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us pray. Those who care for them. We pray for God's blessing and healing.
Margaret Greenwood, Linda Hutchinson, Alan Banks, Marge Williams, James Goodall, Louise Charrett, Harvey Wharton, Elizabeth Hargreaves, and John Smith. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
And we pray for all who have died, for all who have died in faith, that you have mercy on all, and welcome all into the fullness of your kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Thank you, Lord God, for the brightness of your mercy, the completeness of your forgiveness, and the restoration to you in joy. Merciful Father,
accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ.
Christ came and stood among his disciples and said, "Peace be with you. My peace I leave with you." Then they go out and they saw the sight of the risen Lord. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
So we turn off that silent peace to everyone in church and watching at home as well. Service continues with Eucharistic prayer. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is right to praise you, Father, Lord of all creation. In your love you made us yourself. When we turned away, you did not reject us, but came to meet us in your Son. You embraced us as your children, and welcomed us to stay to meet with you. In Christ you shared our life, that we might live in him, and he in us.
He opened his arms of love upon the cross, and made for all the perfect sacrifice for sin.
On the night he was betrayed and suffered with his friends, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His body is the bread of life.
At the end of supper, taking the cup of wine, he gave you thanks and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me."
Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His blood is shed for all.
As we proclaim his death and celebrate his rising in glory, send your Holy Spirit that this bread and this wine may be to us the body and blood of your dear Son.
As we eat and drink these holy gifts, make us one in Christ our risen Lord.
And with your whole church throughout the world, we offer you this sacrifice of praise, and lift our voice to join the eternal song of heaven.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. this your table, bless the Lord. Trusting in our righteousness, but in your manifolds and great mercies, we are not worthy so much as gather up the crumbs from your table. But you are the same Lord, whose nature is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body,
Grant, O Lord, we beseech you, that the course of this world may be so peaceably ordered by your governance, that your church may joyfully serve you in all godly quietness, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Strengthen us in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory.
Amen.
Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, his Son, and the Holy Spirit, be amongst you, and with all whom you hold in your hearts, this day and forevermore. Amen. Go in peace to love and to serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ.
Thank you.